webinar, who is Dr. Ali Talha Khalid. Dr. Ali Talha Khalid is working as assistant professor in the Department of Pathology, Lady Reading Hospital. His research is based on the intersection of nanotechnology, biomaterials, nanomedicines, and biotechnology, besides that, security, safety, and ethics. Dr. Ali Talha Khalid has been working on different lines like on NASI, DNA barcoding, health security, bioethics, and biosafety. Alongside Dr. Khalid is working on the mental health consequences of the current pandemic and the need for proactive approaches to combat future threats. Dr. Ali Talha is going to talk about COVID-19 pandemic as a test case in the Anthropocene of the interplay of environment, ethics, and psychology on the global stage. Please, Dr. Ali Talha, the floor is yours.
Assalamu alaikum, everyone. I hope if you can hear me and if you can have my slides on your screen.
Yes, you are audible. You are audible. Go ahead.
And are the slides visible?
No, the slides are not being shown yet. Sir,
unko apni slides share karengi wo na. नहीं सर उनकी स्लाइड्स हमारे पास नहीं है सर ये वो खुद शेयर कर रहे हैं
यस वी आर विजिबल नाउ डॉक्टर
थैंक यू
वी आर ऑलरेडी बिहाइंड शेड्यूल
श्योर सर थैंक यू वेरी मच फर्स्ट जस्ट अ क्विक वर्ड ऑफ थैंक्स टू एवरीवन द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स द आसा द पाकिस्तान एकेडमी ऑफ साइंसेज एंड ऑल द यू नो द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स हु हैव पुट देयर एफर्ट्स even it is Ramzan and it is the you know the fasting but thank you very much for being here and the topic that which I will be presenting is about the COVID-19 pandemic and it is a test case in the Anthropocene epoch and we will discuss some environmental challenges ethical challenges and psychological issues just about my location and my affiliation as you already know that later I work here as an assistant professor in the Lady Reading Hospital, one of the largest hospital of Peshawar, KP, and it is just around the famous Balahisar Fort. So I hope if somebody visit here, they will have you know have the scenic views of the Peshawar Valley. So just a update on the status. There are the recent data says that you know the infections are increasing. And so is the mortality as well as according to the WHO situational report. And there are more than 50 COVID vaccine candidates that are under the trial. We have the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines already rolled in. And then the important aspect is that that we developed those vaccines. The companies developed those vaccines in the record time. Before it took almost 4 years in 1960s when there was one mumps outbreak, and now they just developed the vaccine in 1 year, so that's really appreciable. At least 7 different vaccines across 3 platforms has been rolled out, and there are 200 additional vaccine candidates in development. As of 22nd April, there are more than 890 million of vaccine doses administered. And of course, we know about the efficacy of those, some of the vaccines that is for Pfizer 95% and for the Moderna as 94.5%. So further update, which you may all, you may all know that the 7 European countries stopped taking the AstraZeneca vaccine because of some safety concerns over the blood clotting. There were some, and that is not common with only with AstraZeneca, but to be fair, there are supposed to be some allergic reactions for other vaccines as well. For example, for Pfizer, they have reported some certain adverse reactions, anaphylaxis, 21 cases, for example. But they were those cases mostly that already have some record of the allergic reactions previously. 17 persons without documented history of among the 21 cases for Pfizer, suffered the anaphylaxis. There were 17% who have not already been documented to have allergic reactions. So they talking about this SARS-CoV-2. It is a smart virus, and it keeps on surprising us. Like it is because of the nature of this virus, because it tends to mutate so rapidly. It has an RNA-dependent polymerase, which means it does not have any proofreading activity. So mutations are supposed to occur. The previous data showed that there were 23 mutations in a variant. Among them, 17 mutations were non-synonymous mutations, which means it can alter the protein sequence of the virus. Some of the mutations have already been shown in the lab that have increased the infectivity of the virus. Recently, just on 6th April, this month, coronavirus was a variant was identified in Angola, and it was reported to have 34 mutations, including 14 in the spike protein, which the virus used to as an entry to the cells. So just about a bit of the morphology of the spike or the structure of the spike. The spike protein has two domains, S1 and S2, and it is you and they. The virus use these domains to enter into the cell through binding to the membranes and fusing to it. A presentation in early days of the pandemic, it was proposed or it was expected by the one of the professors that the vaccine escape mutants will be one of the issues. And now we are seeing that although we have vaccines available and we have rolled out so many vaccines and doses, but still there are some breakthrough infections, coronavirus infection. For example, I am citing here the case of Israel. There are 249 breakthrough infections in people who have already received a single dose of vaccine. So means they are reinfected by some of the mutant strain of the virus. And even those who received two doses of vaccine, there's a report in the Israel that 149 people were reinfected. So vaccine, although it is important, but by no means it provides complete surety of, you know, that we will be safe from the coronavirus infection. And same goes with the Sputnik vaccine. There are reports that it was ineffective against the South African variant. So the point is that virus is adopting and it is evolving. So are we smarter enough to counter? And I will tell you how can we become smart and how can we counter it, the virus. Then there is another issue of the stigmatization of the virus, the social stigma that is very important and that needs a lot of attention. Thing is that hate the virus but not the patients. The social stigma, when there is some kind of a stigma, it creates through a process that we in the social sciences known as othering. That creates a dichotomy and that creates a desirable versus undesirable others. So, means those who are infected are undesired in the society and this creates the stigma. And further, due to the, we already discussed that due to the infodemic and due to the rumors, this social stigma gets further ahead. There was, you know, a case in the Spain in which the ambulance carrying the sick people, COVID patients, and they were stoned in the Spain. And why? Because what they claim, people claim that we have the right that we should not be infected. If you are, you know, if the ambulance are going around the posh areas or something, there are chances that we will get infected. So they were sort of resisting them. So there are, but we will discuss the ethics later on. And then further on the stigma, it seems that we have not learned anything from the history. We already have this case of Mary Mellon. It's still known. She was known to have spread she was asymptomatic carrier of typhoid, of Salmonella, and she is still, and the disease was actually linked to her when it was known, and she was then later in a textbook even quoted as Typhoid Mary. Her name was Mary Mellon. So now it was in 18th century, and now again now it is the after, you know, the century, we are still in the same stage as we are blaming one another. Like, for example, we all know what happened with the China, the Chinese virus and the Wuhan virus, etc. So the point is, we need to avoid such kind of stigma, and we need to learn lessons from the history. So for that, to curb the social stigma, we need to, and we are indeed thankful to the World Health Organization that they have eventually renamed the virus from Chinese virus, actually, when it was known initially, they renamed it to the SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19 virus. The outbreak of the coronavirus has created a social stigma and discriminatory behavior, and I already talked about that. Posted conspiracy theories about the biological warfare, and it all relates to the stigma regarding the coronavirus. And then the stigma can take multiple forms. That was of more of an international level, the previous slide, but even on individual level, we need to protect those people who are infected. You know, we do not need to physically isolate them. We just need to isolate them physically, but not isolate them socially. We should stay in contact with them. We should keep up with them. And there are incidents of stigmatization. We need not to subject them to a social boycott. All the corona patients, there are cases that in India that they were labeled as super spreader, and the stigma has a potential negative effect to prevent the prevent the efforts to spread disease. The ethics of health, of course, autonomy, equity, and health are important pillars of the ethics. But you often see a trade-off between them. So we have to have a balanced kind of a thing. Need for necessary, for example, in autonomy, need for necessary intervention in the interest of the public health without compromising the public liberty. I'll go ahead. Important aspect is autonomy and equity in health. The resources should be equal. We need to have take care of the access and versus the access, and then we need to take care of the vaccine nationalism and vaccine diplomacy. Just one important point here in this slide is the out of the 890 million of vaccine doses, only 0.3% doses were for the low and middle income country. Then there is of course the another point. We need to develop our the facilities for the isolation. They need to be equipped enough to serve our people. Ethics of the digital proximity technologies is important, and important as well. There is a trade-off between the these things that need to be scattered. They're just to be faster. I'm going through it quicker. Doctors have the duty to care and duty to treat, but whether we should hold accountable, those doctors who do not want to see the patients which do not have the PPEs enough supplies. So that's also an issue we need to discuss. Then we have moral and ethical obligations as well. Those who have lost their lives, those who have suffered, we need to get them. We need to help them. We need to mobilize our religious people, religious clerics. We have the ethical obligation of resource allocation, and we have also need to take care of the rights of the incompetent people. These are those people who do not respond to the vaccine. So we are supposed to, take care of that. And then the important aspect of the presentation is about the climate change and the climate crisis. Quick here. The important thing is that if we are we may develop vaccines, we may develop everything, but we need to be prepared, right? If we are not helping, or we are not taking care of our climate, we eventually will face more and more pandemic. And these are all the statistics from one of our paper. I'll just skip that. And this is again, this slide tells you the importance of the One Health issue. We are, and again, this is the environmental thing, and we can discuss it someday if we have time. but we need to know that about 70% of the diseases are of zoonotic origin, these emerging infections. So we need to care, we need to take care of that. And this is again the same. So the way forward is regarding the climate is to support the climate action, encourage sustainable development, aggressive conservation measures, regulated animal trade, and support funding for One Health program. And of course, we need to take care of the infodemic, the epidemiology. WHO has taken efforts for that. They have busted some of the myths. They are available on websites. They can be tracked on the WHO website. Now, one other important aspect of regarding scientific publishing, that there is a phase of the to publish about the COVID-19. And there are, you can see that the more than 70 articles have already been retracted for different reasons. So as a scientist, we need to take care that what were we supposed to publish and what not. We should go for the best communication practices, etc. And this is mental health consequences is also important. The amplification, and I'll just skip that.
Yes, next. We don't.